us is the cat at the theater door. His name, as I ought to have told you before, is really asparagus. But that's such a fuss to pronounce that we usually call him just Gus. His coat's very shabby, he's thin as a rake, and he suffers from palsy that makes his paws shake. Yet he was in his youth quite the smartest of cats, but no longer a terror to mice and to rats. For he isn't the cat that he was in his prime, though his name was quite famous, he says, in his time. And whenever he joins his friends at their club, which takes place at the back of the neighboring pub, he loves to regale them if someone else pays with anecdotes drawn from his palmiest days. For he once was a star of the highest degree. He has acted with Irving, he's acted with Tree, and he likes to relate his success on the halls, where the gallery once gave him 7 catcalls. But his grandest creation, as he loves to tell, was Fire for our Fiddle, the Fiend of the Fell.
I have played in my time every possible part, and I used to know 70 speeches by heart. I'd extemporize, back chat. I knew how to gag, and I knew how to let the cat out of the bag. I knew how to act with my back and my tail. With an hour of rehearsal, I never could fail. I'd a voice that would soften the hardest of hearts, whether I took the lead or in character part. I have sat by the bedside of poor little Nell when the curfew was rung, then I swung on the bell. In the pantomime season, I never fell flat, and I once understudied Dick Whittington's cat. But my grandest creation, as history will tell, was Fire for our Fiddle, the Fiend of the Fell.
Then if someone will give him a toothful of gin, he will tell how he once played a part in East Lynne. At a Shakespeare performance, he once walked on pat, when some actor suggested the need for a cat.
And I say now, these kittens, they do not get trained as we did in the days when Victoria reigned. They never get drilled in a regular troop, and they think they are smart just to jump through a hoop.
And he says, as he scratches himself with his claws,
well, the theater is certainly not what it was. These modern productions are all very well, but there's nothing to equal from what I hear tell. of mystery. When I made history as fire for fiddle, the fiend of the fell. I once crossed the stage on a telegraph wire to rescue a child when a house was on fire. And I think that I still can much better than most produce blood-curdling noises to bring on the ghost. And I once played Growltiger, could do it again, could do it again, could do it again.
Appearance did not calculate to please.
His coat was torn and seedy, he was baggy at the knees.
One ear was somewhat missing, no need to tell you why.
And he scowled upon a hostile world from one forbidding eye. The cottagers of Rotherhithe knew something of his fame. At Hammersmith and Putney, people shuddered at his name. They would fortify the hen house, lock up the silly goose, when the rumor ran along the shore.
Well, Tiger's on the loose!
Woe to the weak canary that fluttered from its cage.
Woe to the pampered Pekingese that face Growltiger's rage.
Woe to the bristly bandicoot that lurks on foreign ships.
And woe to any cat with whom Growltiger came to grip.
But most to cats of foreign races hatred had been vowed. To cats of foreign name and race no quarter was allowed. The Persian and the Siamese regarded him with fear, because it was a Siamese that mowed his missing ear.
Now on a peaceful summer night, all nature seemed at play. The tender moon was shining bright, the barge boldly lay. All in the balmy moonlight it lay rocking on the tide. And the tiger was disposed to show his sentimental side.
Kiela.
Me.
Soon.
peak of the vessel, Growltiger stood alone,
concentrating my attention on the lady Griddlebone, while my raffish crew were sleeping in their barrels and their bunks.
As the Siamese came creeping in their sandbags and their junks,
Growltiger had no eye or ear for Rottweiler's Griddlebone.
And the lady seemed enraptured by my manly baritone, disposed to relaxation and awaiting no surprise. Tepida, no te d'estate, allor che la natura era nel pieno fulgore e la fresca bruciava, splendeva al chiar di luna sopra la vettura, se poteva vedere il galeone ancorato. Oscillare il silenzio nel vento profumato dall'marea del naviglio, serenamente cullato in quella tepida notte che c'è dunque di male. Tanta poesia, il pirata diventa sentimentale. Oscillare in silenzio nel vento profumato dalla marea del naviglio, serenamente colato in quella tepida notte, in quella tepida notte, in quella tepida notte.
Then Genghis gave the signal to his fierce Mongolian horde. With a frightful burst of fireworks, the Siamese swarmed aboard, abandoning their sandpans, their pullaways, and junks. They battened down the hatches on the crew within their bunks. Then Griddlebone, she gave a screech, for she was badly skied. I'm sorry to admit it, but she quickly disappeared.
She probably escaped with ease. I'm sure she was not drowned.
But a serried ring of flashing steel, Growltiger did surround.
Tiger, to his vast surprise, was forced to walk the plank.
He who a hundred victims had driven to that drop, at the end of all his cries, was forced to go ka-flick-ka-flop.
Ah! Oh, there was joy in walking when the news flew through the
Toria Dock and a These modern productions are all very well, but there's nothing to equal from what I hear tell. That moment of mystery when I made it.